So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and welcome to the session of RBI 247. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this session we try to discuss some concepts related to finance and economics, current affairs as well as some static portions which usually the students find difficult, right? So in this session we are not going to discuss questions as usual, but we are going to discuss something new. A topic which was mentioned by one of you in the comments, and I've got a lot of comments regarding that topic. So I hope you find this session beneficial, and now let's not waste any time and move straight away to the session. But before moving to the session, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel and don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. Sorry, it can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to resolve them as soon as possible, right? So the topic for today's special session is Japan's lost decade, right? So we are going to discuss about Japan's economy a little bit in this session, right? So I hope you're going to find it helpful. Okay, first of all, a little introduction. So first of all a little introduction about Japan as a country. So it's an island nation lying off the east coast of Asia, consisting of over 6,000 islands. It is usually called the land of rising sun because it is extremely in the east. Capital is Tokyo. 1/4 of the land is consisting of mountains. Ethnically homogeneous population, there is not much diversity among the population of Japan. People are usually alike, right? Currency is yen. Some basic information. Moving ahead to the next one. Okay, now why are we talking about Japan? Why is Japan so significant? So many of the things you are going to find out gradually in this session, but the first thing, that why Japan is very important as a country, and especially for someone who wants to study the financial or economic system of a country, Japan is a very important country from that from that perspective. Because in Asia, it was one of the first countries to attain the status of a developed nation. It was one country that did not belong to the West, that was lying in the East, in the Asian structure, in the Asian region, but still competed with West on the growth rates, right? So Japan's growth rates were so high at one time that it used to be the envy of the world, and every country wanted to be wanted to have a growth rate like Japan, and the West was scared that whether Japan is going to take over them. Although later some problems erupted, but we are going to discuss about it, right? So country possessing an intricate and ancient cultural tradition, since 1950 emerged as one of the world's most economically and technologically advanced societies. Guys, one thing that is peculiar about Japan is that it is a very resource deficient nation. It is resource deficient. It does not have much resources. That is why it has to depend upon other countries to fulfill its demands for various products, right? So for such a country which is not having much resources on its own and which is very prone to natural disasters, so for them becoming a technologically advanced and to stand in front in the league of developed nations was one great achievement, right? So first non-Western, non-Christian, non-Caucasian country to achieve such a successfully high level of development, right? Here you can see Japan's location in a map, comprises of islands, right? The orange portion you can see, and you can also look at the area which is mentioned here, right? So if you want, you can take a screenshot of these for future use. Okay, now coming to Japan's history. So we are not going to spend too much time on history, just a run through it. First of all, the Edo period. You can say that from economic point of view, this was a time when Japan Japan was not an open economy, but a closed one where it didn't allow foreigners or it didn't allow Westerners to engage much into their economic activities, right? So basically, it was a closed economy totally comprising of different classes, and people were very rigid in those classes. They didn't used to move between the classes, right? So the classes were divided on the basis of the families in which you were born, right? So not a very open period, like Christianity books were not available easily, and the philosophies of other religions. Basically, a closed time, not very liberated time. Moving to the next period, Meiji Restoration. So this was the period in which Japan started opening up to the world, and it started adopting the Western methods or Western procedures, a Western technology, so that it can capitalize on its own asset, that was the human capital, right? So one thing that Japan invested hugely upon was human capital, on the providing social benefits, social security to their citizens, so that they can develop in health and education, right? Because they do not have much resources. So in this period, they started developing, they started adopting the Western technology, which was not allowed in this period. After that came World War One, right? And when World War One ended, it led to the Great Depression, right? So Japan also, like the other economies, it was suffering in the Great Depression, but obviously the effect was not as much as there was on West. After that came World War II. In World War II, Japan played a very important role. For those of you who are curious, you can look up to many articles, many references which are available online. And also there is a web series on Netflix called Tokyo Trial. So I think most of you would be aware that Japan did not win in this war. Japan lost in World War II, and it was captured by US for some time, and US officials, they came there, they changed how things worked in traditional Japan, and they tried to economically break the power of Japan. Because see, in this, before World War II, Japan was growing at a very fast rate, and in World War II there were many allegations put on Japan for the atrocities that it committed on China, right? So when they lost, US officials came there, they took some territory from Japan as a penalty, and obviously made many changes to their economic structure, right? So yes, there is a series called Tokyo Trial, which might get you a glimpse into Japanese world, right? So Irfan Khan also stars in this. So for those of you who are interested. Okay, after that, when World War finished and US officials came, when US officials, when Americans left Japan and Japan was left on its own to develop from the ruins of the war, then it, after some time, it held itself and entered into a phase called post-war development. This is the period which is most glorious in the history of Japan, in which its growth rate became the envy of the world. Every country wanted to have a growth rate like it. So what are the reasons behind it that we are going to discuss? Right, so one major reason was that Japan followed Western technology. They tried to build good relationships with many countries of world, like US, because they had strained past because of the World War, right? So they tried to rebuild their relationships, they tried to rebuild their image, which was not very good because of the atrocities that they committed on China. So they rebuilt their image on a global level. They tried to invest in their human capital, which is one major resource available to them, right? So, and they tried to adopt technology. They didn't close their doors for the Westerners, but tried to take an advantage by imitating their technology, by acquiring their technology and making the best use of it, right? So this was the post-war development. After that comes a phase called lost decade. Started off with the decade, but it is still continuing, right? So after 1990s, till 70s, 80s, Japan was growing very fast, but when it entered 90s, it was not good for Japan because it met with many economic problems. There were recessionary tendencies, demand fell, banks had NPAs, businesses were not flourishing. So all the problems that are related to having a recession were present here. So after that, Bank of Japan, Central Bank tried to take so many measures, but the point is they might have emerged, they might have crossed that phase of recession, but they never attained that growth miracle that they had before the loss ticket, right? So that is why this loss ticket, the name was given to the period of 90s to 2000s, right? But now we are 20 years ahead of this time. We are living in 2020. And these 20 years, they have also not been very good for Japan in terms of their growth, right? So this is like the third loss ticket that Japan is facing, right? So this is a brief history of Japan. Moving ahead to learn in detail about things. Okay, coming to Japan's economic miracle. So we are talking about the period after World War II, when Japan was in the phase of post-war development, when they attained the heights of growth rate, right? So here you can see devastated Japanese economy rose very quickly from World War II. Recovery was followed by the era of rapid growth era. We are going to look at statistics in a while. 1973, you can see that Japan's per capita GDP was 95% that of Britain. And you know how powerful Britain used to be in that time? 69% that of United States. So United States known to be one of the largest, and probably the most powerful country of that time. 1991. So in a period of about 18 years, it became from 95%, it became 120% that of Britain, and 69% it became about 85% that of United States. So it came close to being about 85% of America's economy, right? So you can see the growth here, right? Able to benefit greatly from technology imported from more advanced nations. Since I told you that they were trying to rebuild their relationships. Obviously, United States and Japan, they were from the opposing sides in World War II. But after the recovery, after war ended, Japan tried to mend its relationship. In order to construct the economy following the war, national slogan was export and save. See, since Japan knew that they are resource deficient, that is why they cannot manufacture everything. That is why they need to build these trade relations with other countries so that they can ensure the availability of goods and services. So this was the motto which was given, that export. They were importing this technology from Western nations, using it with their human capital asset and turning it into exports, right? So they invested hugely on technology. They invested hugely on the equipments, machinery that could help them to produce at a very good quality and at a faster rate. So that is why imported technology, which led to higher exports. And when a country exports, it obviously earns foreign exchange, which strengthens it, right? Export and save. So saving portion was for its consumers. So a key element of Japanese success was Kairetsu. Guys, if you remember, in one of the sessions we have discussed about Kairetsu. For those of you who don't know, a brief introduction. Kairetsu, it is like a group of conglomerates. So basically it can be a group. You must have heard about Mitsubishi or Mitsui. These are big conglomerates. One company of this group manufactures cars, so automobile. One might be into banking, one might be into insurance, one might be into manufacturing steel. So basically a group of companies under one name. And these companies, since they are related to each other and they have one major bank amongst them, and this bank tries to support every company of the group. See, keep this in your mind that Japan's banking is based on relationship as compared to the Western banking. In Western world, like US, banking is not based on relationship but more of transaction based, that you go, you do not need to know the banker, you just do your transaction and come back. But in Japan, relationships are very important. They come from Eastern background, Asian background, so traditions, culture and relationships are very important to them, right? That is why they try to build it with the rest of the world. So they work on relationship banking. I think if we talk about India, relationship banking is very important into India also, because if we talk about the steps taken such as banking correspondence or sending, trying to hire people from the remote areas to run their banking branches, so that people feel more connected, people trust the banking officials and they can transact with them. But here, since there was one group under which there are many companies, and these companies, they usually have interlocked shareholdings, that this car company, automobile company might be holding a great stake in this insurance company or in this steel manufacturing company, or let's say there is another company which is into FMCG, right? So they have interlocked shareholding. This is holding shares into this, this is holding shares into this. So one group, they work like a family, different set of industries, different belonging to different sectors, but they work like a family. And there is one bank in between which tries to fulfill the financial needs of all the companies, right? So that is why many a times transactions, financial transactions are very fast in nature. Availability of money is cheap, availability of money is there, and time is not much invested. So the effort on time or the cost of time is not much, right? Because you can do the transactions quickly and at a cheaper rate because of having relationship with the financial institution, right? So this Kairetsu system helped Japan to grow a lot, right? So this Kairetsu, before the World War, it was known as Zaibatsu's, but I think we have discussed it in the session. And for those of you who are curious, you can learn about this, you can ask for that link in the comments in which we discuss this term. So guys, in this session, I think we are going to revise many of the terms that we have randomly learned in many of the sessions, right? So this is going to be a test of your knowledge, that how much you remember. Okay, so Japan's economic miracle. Here you can see Japan's GDP, right? Here the blue line tells you about Japan. This blue line is an indication of Japan. Green is United States and yellow is China. I hope these are visible on screen. Okay, so blue Japan, green US and yellow China. You can see Japan properly imitating China till 1990s. Here you can see had its peak in the beginning of 1990s, and then it started to stagnate. Here it achieved its peak and then fell, then rose a little bit, basically not rising at a steep rate but being a little bit stagnated in this particular range. But here you can see, right, starting from 75, you can see how fast it is growing. Till here it is stagnated, but from this point, 1975 onwards to 1995, you can see a steep growth, an imitation of US economy, right? So it is growing parallel to the US economy. China is also, although stagnated in this period, but China achieves this growth rate after 2005, right? So you can see the growth in China and how it surpasses Japan, right? I hope this this infographic is clear. Moving ahead, here you can see the growth rates. Japan having such a high growth rate in the period of about 1970, ranging from 1970 to 1980 about, approximately, right? So this dotted line, Japan, darker line, this is US, this is Japan, right?
and this line is euro area. To compare, a comparison of some major regions of the world, you can see this one is UK. So here is UK, US, Japan and the euro area, right? So I hope you can view this is properly visible to you. Moving ahead, I think these two infographics show you what was the speed of the growth of the country, right? Okay, now everything going good, higher growth rates, technology, good relations with the world, everything moving too good, right? Now, what went wrong suddenly? Where did Japan go wrong? Let's learn about those reasons. Now, see, if you are having an economic boom for a long time, that is going to show its effects, because then it is going to, if the regulators do not do anything, do not take any steps to control that growth rate, because if an economy is growing at a very fast rate, then also it needs to be controlled, because if it's overheating and the growth is because of speculation and creation of asset bubbles, then it needs to be stopped. The growth pace needs to be slowed down, right? So Japan's regulator, they didn't do it very quickly. They didn't realize it. They were just enjoying the benefits of having a very high growth rate, but they didn't realize what was going to happen in future, right? So this growth led to speculation. Obviously, if people are having money, there is much liquidity in the economy, they are going to invest it somewhere. And if many people invest in one particular area, that is going to lead to asset bubbles. So asset bubble also, it has been discussed in one of our previous sessions. What is an asset bubble? What are its implications? So too much money flowed into stock market and real estate speculation, that led to high prices. After that, one thing happened called Plaza Accord. Plaza Accord, it was like an agreement of five nations, that were France, Germany, US, UK and Japan. So five major economies of the world, they sat together and their leaders had an agreement, and they said that US, they are going to depreciate, they are going to change some exchange rate, they are going to depreciate US dollar in relation to Japanese yen and German mark. So what were the reasons behind this? So I'm going to tell you in short. See, US dollar, as you know, is the reserve currency of the world, right? Now, when there was too much demand for US dollar, because every country wanted to have dollar as a foreign reserve to safeguard itself, there was a huge demand for dollar. And this huge demand led to very high appreciation of dollar. And obviously, if a currency is appreciated, that means it becomes expensive for the rest of the world, which led to fall in exports of US. So domestic industry was facing problems because of this huge appreciation of dollar, because it was in too much demand, being the liquid asset of the world, being the reserve currency of the world, right? So domestic manufacturers of US were having much problems. And at the same time, countries like Japan, they were exporting cheaper goods into US, and American customers were happily adopting them. That is why US regulators were concerned that we have to stop this appreciation, otherwise other countries are going to bring in cheaper goods and our domestic manufacturers will not be able to export, right? So to reduce this problem, they sat with these countries and they tried to have measures, like they told that we are going to depreciate our currency, because if they we are going to devalue our currency, we are going to reduce the value of dollar, because if we reduce the value of dollar, it will be cheaper to the world and American goods are going to be cheaper to the rest of the world, right? So guys, there's a question for you here in this session. Okay, US was in problem. So US told Japan and Germany that let's do this. Let's try to, basically Japan wanted to balance its trade or balance its deficit, right? It wanted to control its deficit balance with these two countries, especially these two countries, Japan and Germany, right? So US agreed to the agreement. What incentives do you think Japan and Germany had? Like, why would Japan agree? Japan was having a good time. It was exporting the products to US and there was no problem with it. Why do you think they agreed to be a part of this agreement? Because they knew their exports were going to be, as they knowing that their exports are going to be expensive for American consumers if they agree to this agreement. So why do you think they agree? This is my question for you, and I expect to see a lot of answers in the comments. Okay, so Plaza Accord, speculation in real estate. So these two reasons led to creation of asset bubble, right? So because of this, Japanese yen became really strong in comparison to US dollar. So led to a creation of asset bubble, strong yen, great expansionary monetary policy contributed to asset bubble of the late 1980s, right? As a result, through the 1990s and 2000s, Japan experienced a prolonged period of growth and deflation. Now, when this asset bubble got created, and after that, when it burst, it led to sudden fall in the valuation of real estate as well as these stocks, the share market. And suddenly, a lot of loss was there to the investors who were trying to inflate this asset bubble, or who were just the victims of this frenzy of buying, right? So when this bubble burst, Japan entered into this phase called lost decade. I hope everything is clear till here. Okay, here you can see the strong yen, and as compared to US, obviously it affected Japan's exports fell, and there were many other problems which are related to sudden appreciation of yen, because obviously it got suddenly appreciated, and that is why it led to inflation, and there were its exports also got affected, right? Here you can see the impact. Japan's equity and real estate bubbles burst starting in the fall of 1989. Equity values plunged 60%, while land values dropped throughout the 1990s, falling an incredible 70% by 2001. You can see the impact here, right? Sudden fall, sudden losses to everyone. Now, what did the regulators do? Let's learn about it a little bit. Okay, I think most of the concepts we have already learned. First, slow response from Bank of Japan. As I told you, regulators do not realize when the growth rates are too high because they are busy enjoying that, right? They cannot get the signals that something bad might happen in future. So the response of Central Bank of Japan, Bank of Japan, was slow. And when they realize that this asset bubble has been created and we need to curb it, they raise the interest rates. They suddenly raise the interest rates, but they also help the overall economy slide down into a downward spiral. Although it helped to cool down the economy, but suddenly people started to save a lot, or industries, they were not spending because they were too scared, or they were too afraid to spend, or just there was a tendency to hoard cash, right? So that is why no expansion. Economy suddenly it came to a halt because of the higher interest rates. In 1991, equity and land prices fell because of this. Bank of Japan, when saw this, that okay, they are suddenly falling, there is no money in the market, right? So guys, I hope the transition is clear. A creation of asset bubble, lot of liquidity in the market, and suddenly the regulators, they wake up and they realize we have to control the overheating economy. They raise the interest rate, and suddenly everything just comes to a halt because businesses and individuals, consumers, they are too scared to spend their money, right? That is why land prices fell. And when Bank of Japan wanted to reverse this, they tried to cut the interest rate, but still they were not able to make people spend. I think seems similar. Have you heard this? Have you heard of this in current times? I think most of the world is facing this problem. Regulators are trying to make people spend and businesses spend, but they are not able to boost spending. That is what happened with Japan. And that is why it entered into a phase of liquidity trap. It was too late. Liquidity trap had already been set. I hope we all understand the meaning of trap. And if you do not understand, we have already discussed it in detail in one of the sessions. You can ask for its link, right? So a liquidity trap, it's set where simply it is a phase where people do not spend. They are too scared of spending. They want to hoard cash because they expect that something bad is going to be there in the future. Credit crunch. Leading to credit crunch, obviously no one is taking loans. Everyone is scared to spend. So who will take loans? No one is buying cars. No one is taking home loan, no one is taking car loan, which obviously led to fall in the prices of real estate and land and all the other assets. And banks were also not willing to lend that easily because they were scared that people will not be able to pay. Borrowers, they will not be able to pay. That is why they held their hand back at lending. Economic scenario, banks have tightened lending for most of the part, do not lend. Japan suffered from it. And since there was suddenly a stoppage of the circulation of money, led to zombification of companies. So zombification, liquidity trap, asset bubble, all these terms have been already discussed in our previous sessions. What is zombification? That companies, due to lack of money, they were not able to make profits and there was no demand in the economy. There was no selling of products and services. Only the essentials were getting sold. It led to companies becoming non-functional or led to huge losses for companies who were just surviving because of the support provided by government, but they were not having any capability of their own. So, zombification of companies. So, Japan tried to take several measures. As I told you, the regulators, they again started to cut interest rate, but it was of no use. Generally believed that these measures were not executed well. So, this is also one of the reasons that, okay, they were spending, Japan's regulators, they were spending, government was spending, they were cutting interest rate, right, trying to boost the economy. But this money was not going into productive firms. Probably this was going into firms which were not very good, very efficient, and not able to make the best use of this money. So, this led to zombification of companies. Wasted money wasted on inefficient public works project and given to failing businesses. See, government spending money is fine. But where you spend it, that is what you have to see. That where you are spending it, whether it be able to create employment, whether it will be able to generate money in the next round or not. Right? So, these were some factors which just put a halt to Japan's growth. Okay. Coming to the economics given by Shinzo Abe, right? I think this is a very popular word. It refers to Abenomics. It refers to the policies, economic policies of former Prime Minister of Japan, Shinzo Abe, at the outset of his second term. After serving as Prime Minister briefly from 2006 to 2007, then he began his second term in 2012. And obviously, he knew that Japan had been witnessing stagnated growth rates for about 20 years, for about two. So Japan has had witnessed two lost decades. They had to do something. Then he came up with an ambitious plan under which there were three arrows or three main pointers. We are going to learn about it. And this came to be known as Abenomics. So it is just like Reaganomics associated with different political figures. There is Reaganomics, there is Clintonomics associated with different leaders of different countries, what policies they brought in time, in difficult times, right? Just like it, Abenomics. So it was obviously, see, the measures were very simple that we know that they will try to boost money into economy, infuse liquidity. So it was a mix of reflation we have already discussed in previous sessions, government spending, growth strategy designed to jolt the economy out of suspended animation. Suspended animation means the stagnated growth rates that had been gripping the economy for about two decades. Okay, these were the three arrows as per the policies given by Shinzo Abe. First, printing of additional money, obviously infusing liquidity. After that, second arrow, new government spending on programs to stimulate demand and consumption. So, government spend, so printing of additional money, government spending, and after that, reforms of industries, making industries more efficient and improving the ease of doing business so that it is easier to do business, right? So, three arrows. Although these three arrows, the result of them were not very good because after that also Japan was not able to pull up its growth rate, right? Okay. Japan also tried to go into the negative territory by cutting down its interest rates to the negative level. So guys, if you remember, we have discussed in the implications of negative interest rate. When do companies go to negative, sorry, when do countries go on to cut their interest rates to a negative level. So Bank of Japan announced quantitative easing in 2013, right? So I think that these are just some statistical description. You can read about it, and there's nothing new to discuss. Here you can see a graph of interest rates. Here you can see interest rates falling to the negative territory. So this was the time in 2012 when Shinzo Abe was elected the prime minister, right? So here it is the negative territory entered about in about mid-2016. Japan's interest rate entered into negative territory. It means that if you keep your money into bank, you're not going to get any interest. Rather, you would have to pay the bank to store your money. That is what negative interest rates mean. So why would you want to keep your money in banks? You would want to spend it on goods and services which you can utilize. So this was the main purpose. Many countries do it, although not much have been successful in boosting the economy through negative interest rate, but it is one of the measures which Japan also took, and many countries have also tried it. Okay, coming to the recent term, Japanification. Now, what is Japanification? So whatever we learned about here, be it the credit crunch, be it liquidity trap, be it zombification, guys, I just told you that these are the terms that we have recently discussed in our sessions in past few months, right? That means these terms are coming back into the news. And why are they so? Because of COVID. Because of COVID, almost all the countries of the world, at least majority of the countries of the world, have been witnessing these stagnated growth rates. Just like Japan has been doing it for about 3 lost decades or for about 30 years, right? So this is known as Japanification of the entire world, or a particular country which is going to face similar economic problems just as Japan, right? So that is why I've been telling you that this situation, this Japan's lost decade, probably the entire world is going to face it. If you remember, Geeta Gopinath, IMF's chief economist, she recently mentioned that most of the world is going through a liquidity trap. Most of the world, not one or two countries, right? So that is why I thought Japan's lecture was important in this context to understand what is Japanification, the term which has been going on in market for a few months, and what are the implications of it. And now we have to think, how can we get out of this situation? Obviously, the tools are simple, but the implications or the result of the tools that the regulators have to control. Term used as shorthand for the economic problems that crippled Japan, right? Western investors' fear of COVID-19 may herald Japanese style. So basically, Japanification of US and Europe, that means they might face the same problems as Japan, and world might be transitioning into a Japanese style era of economic stagnation. So that would imply a continual dependence on fiscal and monetary pump priming. This term has already been discussed, pump priming to fight pandemic deflation, which has been caused by COVID-19 at the cost of even bigger government debt. So economists have been saying that do not worry about government debt now, just try to boost the economies and we'll look about debt in future. But we'll have to wait and watch what happens with the world, whether the world comes out of this Japanification phase or we are going to go deeper into this mess. So guys, this is it for this session, and I hope you found this session beneficial. And if you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Till then, you take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here. Sayonara.